kick in?
Yep. Yep.
You competing with Sam?
You know what you do? Oh, no. I don't try that.
I said something one day about him politicking, and Suzanne said, "You must be jealous."
Sam the man, okay. He's the trick.
Yep. Oh, this one works. This came with this bag. I bought it when we were going to Mazatlan the last time. It's got so many zippers on it. Plus, you can't cut that too easily. With scissors. And I got this.
Oh, in the water?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And so I tried it one on a coyote running in the wash, pantano wash. Didn't stop, didn't look left or right, just kept trotting along. I said, okay. And I was walking over there one day and I saw a mountain lion.
Oh.
And they tell me that the animals use pantano wash to go from one mountain range to the other, use their highway. But I've been nervous ever since.
They're not to be missed with. When I walk up, I've got a fanny pack, but I carry one of these little spray containers.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be good for mountain lions and bears.
Maybe I ought to get one. I'm just messing with my physical exercise.
Mountain lions, bears, and Sam.
Hi, Miss Helen, how you doing?
Thank you.
Are you planning to be here next week?
Okay.
I have as part of my ordination process, I have to submit a video of a sermon. So I was wondering, because I'm preaching next week, and I said, well, my brother's here, I can just submit that in my YouTube link or something.
This one is complicated, you know. You see that red? That's what hearing on the screen, that's what gets recorded. And, you know, you move the box around, you get to different parts, different people.
Yeah.
That's good. Yeah, I had to go back home this morning because I forgot my SD card.
If you're here then next week, I really appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem.
It's good to see you, man.
Good to see you.
Thank you. 14 second one on
that. That was my first effort.
But that was not bad. Not a bad effort, okay? Yeah.
That's going to be great.
I tell you, yeah. You're going to get too expensive for F1 these days.
Well, you know, I'm trying to learn this new program.
Yeah.
And it's harder than ever.
Yeah, then, though?
The older you get, you know.
Yeah, I hear you. The older you get. Tell me about it.
No.
Thank you. Sanctuary, a table on the left. We have a nice red little folder with some St. Paul's information, propaganda that we want you to take home with you and enjoy. It's true propaganda, though. Okay, what more can I say? But we are delighted you are here this morning. We have a lot going on today. As you will notice, today is our health fair day. And over in Brumman Hall, somewhere out there, in Brumman Hall, we have a lot of stuff going on. I think you get your blood pressure checked, you get a flu shot, maybe a pneumonia shot if you have jumped through all the hoops on that. There are just so many things that you can go and get information and get checked out on. Let me encourage you after the service this morning. I did not give you permission to sneak out. Okay. All right. You might know a retired preacher's wife would be the first one to try. Oh, it didn't start till 9 o'clock. Okay, good, good. Don't you leave halfway through the service, okay? And what I'll be at the end. Okay, all right. Here's some things we need to know. Halloween Days is coming. It's October 27th from 4 to 6 p.m. here at our church facilities. We still need a couple of leaders, someone to leave the haunted house. We need some volunteers, trunk or treat cars. If you can help, get in touch with Meredith, who is our family ministry director. If you can't help but you want to donate, hey, we need candy and kids' books and small prizes for games. We need a big push for the fall break food drive that ends in 1 week on September 29th. We have committed to sending food boxes for 10 families at each of the three schools that we participate with. We need more of the non-perishable things, fries, has mac and cheese, soup, pasta, peanut butter, all kinds of things, okay? And we've been told that when the parents receive the food, some have said that because they don't have to buy food for a week, they can actually pay their electric bill. Let's keep that in mind, folks. We would like now to introduce a very, very special person. So, Tamara, would you come and join me today, please?
Yes, sir.
Did y'all catch that?
Yes.
Okay. I had a funny thing happen after we had hired Tamara. Meredith came into the office, and we're kind of all hanging around there. And I don't remember exactly what she said, but she was talking to me, and she was saying something about Tamara. And I'm sad. Well, I don't know if I have that on my calendar for tomorrow. She wasn't talking about tomorrow after today. She was talking about our new staff person. I want to introduce to you Tamara Suna, who is now our new, you are membership secretary plus other things.
Other things, whatever needs to be done.
Yes, and I don't know if they told you, but at the bottom of every job description, there's this little phrase and anything else that the senior pastor wishes you to do. Isn't that right, Ed?
It is.
Always there, okay? But tomorrow, now you were born
in Jordan.
In Amman, Jordan. And your family lineage actually goes back to?
To the tribe, the same tribe that Ruth from the Bible came from.
The tribe of?
There's no name.
Well,
we just know that we're descended
yes.
from the same tribe that she came from.
Okay.
We are from Moab.
Okay. And
biblical Moab.
Yes, and you grew up as a
Greek Orthodox, which is very similar to Catholic, but there are some minor differences. But I come from a family, a great lineage of priests. My great uncle was a priest, his father, and the priesthood can be traced in our family back to the 3rd century. There is a church in the south of Jordan called St. George Church. And it has a mosaic map of all of the Middle East, Jerusalem, made from little stones, little mosaics, and that is in the church that my family have been, they call them guardians of that church.
Yes.
So the church is called St. George Church in Madaba. Madaba is the city where it's from, and it's in, and it's a mosaic on the floor. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Oh, now you can hear me, okay. No, I don't usually do this.
Okay.
So I'm from the south of Jordan, from Moab. My father is from a city called Madaba, which is filled with Roman architecture, Roman artifacts. My grandmother's house was actually, we discovered, was built on top of a Roman palace. The church that my family has been from, or like guardians of, where like my grandfathers and great uncles have been priests, they have found mosaic maps on the floor that date back to the 3rd century. So that's just a little bit of the heritage that I came from, and women from the south, from Moab, we are held to a higher standard when it comes to God and our relationship with God, because we do come from a very, a place where an amazing woman like Ruth came from.
Mm-hmm.
So our behavior reflects on whatever she was. So if I misbehave, I bring shame to her name. If I behave properly and the way God would want me to, then I bring glory to that name, to this amazing woman. So
wonderful, wonderful. So tomorrow has brought us back to our biblical roots, folks, and I think that's fantastic. We'd like to do something around here tomorrow to, when we pray and bless someone, we have this thing where we all just kind of do this, and so everybody join me, let's raise our hands toward tomorrow. Lord, we thank you for bringing tomorrow to us. We are so thankful that she has become a valuable part of our team here at St. Paul's. Bless her in her work. May she truly become one of us as we journey together in your holy name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's give Tamara a big round of applause. Thank you. And by the way, it's interesting, you know, you hire staff people, they come on board. Not tomorrow. She bought me a gift when she came on board, and I'm wearing it this morning. This lovely cross necklace is something very special to me, and now the rest of the staff needs to... No. But I just want to thank her for this lovely, lovely gift. We are so pleased to have her. And Efrain is her staff supervisor. And so, welcome tomorrow.
Thanks.
Alrighty. And now let us enter into our worship.
Praise Jesus. Y'all sound very good this morning. Let us take a moment to pass the peace of our Lord.
please. Oh, please do. Please do.
You would have to run away. You can't run.
Please be with you, brother.
Peace be with you, George.
So is it a crucifix or is it?
Yes, it is a crucifix. Yeah, it just keeps flipping around. Isn't that neat? And it's made out of, oh, what are they?
Is it about olive?
Olive wood, yes, yes. Her brother got that for me. He was over in Bethlehem and bought it there. So, yeah, yeah.
Shake my hand?
Yeah, I turned the sound all the way down. Is that usually here?
Yeah, you
do. I turned it all the way, I turned it up. No, I turned it down. If you're not here, I leave it like it is.
I love you, George. I don't care what you say.
We're coming down today.
May the peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Amen.
And also with you.
Friends, our hymn for today is number 191, Jesus Loves Me. You may remain seated for this one, okay? Sing loud and enjoy.
If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain none. Love is patient, love is kind, love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends, but as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when complete comes, the part will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know full, even as I have fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, the greatest of these is love. Hear what the Holy Scripture is saying to the church.
Thank you. Thanks be to God.
Friends, let us now take a moment to collect this morning's tithes and offerings. Interlinear
Greek English New Testament this morning. I was privileged back in the day when seminaries had majors and minors just like universities. And believe it or not, my major was biblical languages, especially Greek. And I took about 27 hours of Greek New Testament studies, little of which I still remember. One of the funniest moments I had, though, I was pastoring a small church and had another church along with it, and the small church had a revival. And one of my very best friends, Reverend Cliff Lamb, came up to do the preaching. Cliff was an interesting kind of guy. And one of those small interesting things was, when he came to the revival services, he didn't bring his Bible with him. And before he would get up and preach, he'd say, "Give me your Bible, Ken." So I'd give him my Bible. Well, I decided it was time to teach him a lesson. So the last night we were there, and he turned around and says, "Give me your Bible." I handed him this. Thank goodness there were only two steps up on top of where the altar was, where he was preaching. Because as he's walking and getting to the steps, he opens that thing. And all of a sudden, he threw it up in the air and he turned around and he says, "My Lord, Archer, what are you doing?" And he brought his Bible with him from then on. Today, we bring this series of sermons to a close. I Grace. Started with Amazing Grace. And we moved into integrity, generosity, respect, accountability, compassion, and today, excellence. Lord, let my words be words with excellent thought and preparation. Let the hearers receive the words with excellence in hearing and then going forth and doing the word. Thank you, God, for how you graced us, and so may we grace others. Amen.
Amen.
1 Corinthians 13, known as the love chapter. And a lot of people just kind of read it as a ode to love, never thinking about where it's situated in Scripture and why it's there. And so for a brief moment, let's look at the backlight that preceded what Paul wrote. The church at Corinth was like a lot of churches today. It was filled with the good, the bad, and the ugly. Yeah. They could be so good, but they could be so mean. Paul got on to the women in that church. I don't agree with him, but he had a whole different culture than I'm in today. And at some point in one of those letters, he just literally said, "Hey, women, keep your mouth shut in church." He really did. How do you think that would fly if he came to St. Paul's and preached that? They were taking the Lord's Supper, what we call Holy Communion. And back in those days, it was done as a full meal deal. And some of the people who were coming were eating more than their share of the meal, and when some of the poor folks would show up later, there wasn't any communion for them. And Paul let them have it and said, "You need to stop eating in an unworthily fashion." Notice, it's not unworthy. It's not an adjective. It's unworthily. It's an adverb. And he let them have it with both barrels. This was also a church that had great gifts. We call them spiritual. and sad to say, some people worship at the altar of spiritual gifts. And some of those people did. They really worshiped at the altar of tongues. Now, there's a whole lot of issue and debate about all the tongue stuff, but when you read Paul carefully, if you're talking about the ecstatic utterance of tongues that some people take such great pride in, Paul reminds them that that particular gift is the most minor gift. Why? Because you're the only one it blesses. Nobody else understands your gibberish. Nobody understands my Arkansas. But nobody understands that. And Paul said, you would be better to speak 10 words that were understandable than to speak 1,000 words that nobody understands. Pretty pointed, right? Pretty pointed. And then when it's done, it should be done in the context of an interpreter. Many years ago, in fact, was in Dallas, Texas area, and the couple we were with wanted to go to the church where one of them's parents went, and we went to this huge, huge Assembly of God church. And sometime during that service, some woman out in the sanctuary, Paul was told women to keep their mouths shut in church, but here's a woman getting up and speaking in tongues, right? One's wrong, one's okay. So she's speaking in tongues, and then a guy gets up somewhere in the sanctuary, and he interprets it in beautiful King James English with the these, the thys, the thous, and the those. Quite interesting. And with that setting, and with the people who were caught up in their spirituality. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with being spiritual, folks, but like I say, if we're not careful, we can come to where we worship our spirituality. Like, I'm more spiritual than you are. My gift is greater than your gift. I'm closer to God than you are because I don't do the things you do. So Paul writes what has now become 1 Corinthians 13 as a corrective to some really bad theology. And he begins with some ifs. I'm still a pretty big Dallas Cowboy fan. I loved, back in the days, Don Meredith. He played for Southern Methodist University. Who couldn't love that being Methodist? And then he played for the Cowboys, got his nose broke several times and those kind of things. Later on, he became an announcer, and he was there with Howard Cosell. Some of us remember that. I loved those days of announcing. Those guys had fun. And on one occasion, Howard Cosell is saying, you know, if so-and-so and if so-and-so, but so-and-so and if so-and-so would happen, and Don Meredith came up with the classic response. He said, hey, Howard, if ifs and buts was candy and nuts, we'd all have a Merry Christmas. One of my favorite all-time quotes. Because here we have the ifs. If I could speak in the tongues of angels and just amaze the church and the world, but have not love, I'm nothing but a clanging cymbal and a noisy gong, a bunch of racket. If I could get up and preach and could draw all the peoples of Tucson to my preaching and just was as eloquent and lost that Arkansas attribute of speech, if I could be perfect in my preaching, but have not love, I've said nothing. And he goes on and says, and if I could give the greatest offering, And one Sunday morning years ago in another church, about 10 minutes before we started to worship, a man literally walks up to me and says, "You know, preacher, I give $30,000 a year to this church, and you don't do what I want." You know what I responded? "You should be glad I do what you want." I don't know if he kept giving us $30,000 or not. I didn't check to see. But I thought, my Lord, if I give the greatest offering and stand and brag to the highest heavens about what I give, and I've done it without love, I'd be better giving that. Seriously. If I could even sacrifice myself, if I could go out and burn myself, and we've seen that, haven't we? We've seen pictures of people who set themselves on fire as a way to protest. Horrible. What a painful way to die. If I sacrifice myself and even do that to myself as a part of the sacrifice, but do not do it out of love, I'm nothing. Folks, the more excellent way is not the way of the ifs and the buts. It's a better way. And Paul then moves into where he names a couple of things about what the excellent way is. Love is patient. Love is kind. The word patient there is really, there's a better word for it that the Greek would offer us. And that word is, love suffers long. Love suffers long. Love doesn't leave the bedside of someone who's dying. It suffers long. Love doesn't give up on someone who, say, has AIDS. Love doesn't back away and say, "I can't get near you. I can't touch you." Love suffers long with our family members who are going through everything from financial issues to marital issues to whatever. Love suffers long. We don't give up. And love is kind. Love is kind. Yesterday, I got to go be a part of something really big in this church. That is the upward basketball league that we have. 140 kids. I prayed at every one of the games yesterday. And I witnessed something that is just tremendous. I witnessed watching coaches who were actually kind to their kids. I watch the referees, and one of those referees will be, I suppose, in the 11 o'clock service. I think Jerry comes to the 11 o'clock service. Jerry's been refereeing for years. But here's this man who's used to being tough out on the court with older kids. There is Jerry out there. When he did call a foul, he would call the child over to him, and in a kind and compassionate way, he would explain what's happening. What's that old song says? Try a little kindness. Show a little kindness. Because we're on the road with a lot of people who have a very narrow mind and they're on a narrow road. Be kind. I used to sing in this gospel quartet while I was in college. And one of the songs we sang had a verse, "Be kind to one another, be kind to one another, be kind to one another. For God is kind to us all." The road to excellence is paved with long suffering and kindness. But it's also a page with some things we need to give up. I'm going to rehearse a few of these with us. Love is not jealous. Uh-oh. I've had people walk out and say, "Preacher, you quit preaching today, and you started mad." When I read these things, oh, Lord have mercy, there is meddling going on. Love is not jealous. Love does not brag. Love does not boast and puff itself up. Love doesn't behave disgracefully. Love does not seek the things of itself. I'm going to stop right there. We live in the most narcissistic time period in the history of America. And I don't care what your politics is, who you are, and how you vote. We live in a narcissistic time in America. You look at the selfies we take. My Lord, I'm so ugly, I don't want to hold a camera out there and take my picture 15,000 times a day. And yet you walk around and you see people all the time, and here they are, taking a selfie. And the leadership of our nation is possibly the worst and most narcissistic it's ever been. I'm sorry. It thinks about nothing but itself and what it can do for itself. Folks, the road to excellence is not paved with narcissism. Love is not provoked. Love doesn't keep a record of wrongs. Y'all got that? We pastors are judged from the moment we are announced as moving to a church. And all we have to do is have a mustache, be bald-headed, be an old geezer, or whatever. And judgment is passed. And those judgments prevail. And the people keep a record of everything the pastor does that that individual doesn't approve of. So that means there's a jillion of you who keep a record of me and only one of me to keep a record of you. And you know what? I don't keep records. I don't keep records. Because God has sent me here to love you in spite of who you are and what you do, and vice versa. Love doesn't rejoice over unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth. Have you ever met somebody who seems so happy when other people fail? You ever run into that? Yeah, we just get all lathered up when somebody else falls off of the boat. And we go home and we say, "Well, did you hear about Brother So-and-so and what he did last week?" Shame on us. The road to excellence is not paved with keeping records and seeing ourselves as more righteous than anybody else. And so Paul put all these things together and says, "Well, how does all this now stack up?" He says, well, there are three things. There's faith. And we see faith becoming sight, don't we? We have faith that certain things will happen, and they do happen. And there will come a day when all our faith issues will totally become sight. There will come a day when we will not need faith. There will be a day. How about hope? And I'm not talking about, "I hope Arizona wins next week." I'm talking about the hope that we have in this God who has come to us in the body of Jesus and has offered us a hope to overcome everything that would hurt us and tempt us in this life. One day, We will enter a door and that hope will be totally fulfilled. One day there will not be a need for tongues. One day there will not be a need for great preaching. That's what I'm going to like about heaven. I'm going to get to play 42 and pet my animals, and I'm going to have a great life. If you think heaven is going to church 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, I'm going to go off with the 42 crowd. My hope will be fulfilled. But there's one thing that's going to always remain. Love. And that's why, you know what I find interesting? How hateful and mean and ornery we, notice I always say we, okay? How we can be all these things, right? And then we say, oh, but I'm going to go to heaven one day, and we're all going to be happy, and we're going to be in love. Folks, if it's going to happen up there, why can't we practice it down here? I find it hard to believe that people I hate down here, that all of a sudden I'm going to go to heaven. The best thing that can happen to us is when we go to heaven, is that everybody we've hated and disliked, that's where we have to live. Okay? Folks, I show you a more excellent way. How do we practice excellence? Living lives of faith, sharing messages of hope, but most of all, letting the love of Jesus that we have fallen in love with, letting that love spread from us to everyone that we come in contact to, and everyone in all of God's creation. Because there is no one that's ever been created that God hasn't loved. Love, when everything else is gone, love will be the way of excellence. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
You know, I'm reminded of that passage in Scripture where this young rich man goes to Jesus and says, Jesus, what can I do to be saved? And Jesus basically gives him something to do in regards to his neighbors, right? He says, sell what you got, give it to the poor and follow. Just makes me think, when I have my eyes on my personal salvation, God is calling me to serve, and God is calling me to give, and God is calling me to be kind and generous. So anyway, that's one of the things that I appreciate about that. Friends, let's take a moment to share our joys and our prayer requests this morning. If you have a joy or a God moment, something that happened this week that you feel God was speaking to your heart, please share it with us. We would love to pray with you today. And I'm going to ask you to speak loud so that the people in the back can hear you, okay? So who has a prayer request or a joy this morning?
It's probably a prayer request and a joy. Greta Thurgard. And if you don't know who she is, go online and Google her. She is a child who is trying her best to save this planet.
Amen.
And we need to stop throwing the trash out of the car window, utilize everything that we can, and know that God approves.
Yeah, let me actually share something that I saw online that I really appreciate. You got to hear from that. What was that? So you commend Greta Thunberg. It says, those commenting on Greta Thunberg would do well to remember that Joan of Arc led an army to Jane Austen wrote her first work. Sojourner Truth escaped slavery. Anne Frank kept her journal. And Malala won the Nobel Prize at the same age. Young women are fierce when changing the world. That just blessed my heart. And I think you're right. Sometimes we don't give people the credit that they deserve sometimes because of different factors. But if we pay attention, we appreciate the work that someone is doing, we can see wonderful things in everybody's life. Yes, so thank you for that reminder.
I have been asking prayers for my coworkers, brother,
for a granddaughter who's kind of going through a dark valley.
Anybody else? For your great grandmother's hips, if they have been hurting and you're praying, let's pray that she gets back, right? Anybody else? Friends? Yes.
My wife Mary is having a birthday this Thursday, and so we'll be celebrating that.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. I'm very excited. This last week, I wasn't here on Sunday, not because I didn't want to be. I miss you all very much. But I was out on a retreat, which is called the 5-Day Academy for Spiritual Formation. It was very long, but it was such a blessing. We got to hear from a rabbi, and we got to hear from a professor at Claremont School of Theology. It was full of great information, but not just that. We also had an opportunity to connect with other people, to worship God, and to just have a wonderful experience. So I just wanted to share that with you. I know there will be more activities like that coming up in the future. Every 2 years that happened. So I will let you know, and if anybody's interested in participating, I'll let you know when that time comes. But I just wanted to share with you what a blessing it was for my life this week. Friends, let us pray. Yes, one more.
God have mercy. Shirley and I are going back to our home state, Iowa. And I'd also like prayers for my son-in-law, Ira, who needs healing prayers this morning. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. Let us pray. Holy God, everything that we have received from you, our family, our health, our jobs, day by day, God, we get to experience your grace, and your love, and your patience. Today, God, we just want to take a moment to lift each other up. There's people that we know, people in our congregation who may be struggling, and we pray that you are with them, that you bring healing to their lives, that you give them comfort. To those who are struggling, give them comfort. To those who are too comfortable, God, we pray that you make us uncomfortable to do your will. You have heard what's in our hearts, but God, we also pray for those things that were not mentioned. Sometimes it's hard to put into words those things that are in our hearts, but you know us intimately. And so once again, as one body, as one church, we affirm that our trust, our faith, our strength, our joy is in you alone. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. And God's people say, Amen. Let us now pray the prayer that the Lord taught us, that he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
this time we're preparing to sing our closing hymn of worship. And what we're doing is we'll sing one verse, then following the benediction, we'll sing two other verses. But I also want you to know that St. Paul's United Methodist Church, we are always receptive to you who would have interest in becoming members of the church, whether it's by a commitment to faith and baptism, or whether it's by transfer from another Methodist church or from other denominations, or maybe you don't have any of that paperwork. We don't worry about that. We're open to you. You can see Efrain or myself after the service. You can even walk down this aisle and say, "Preacher, we're interested in joining the church," and we'll have a conversation later about that. But as we stand and sing, the doors of our church are open to you. Let us stand. Become excellent in our love.